most people live so much for the moment. But shortwave craft, I'll have to preface it this way, that across the street from me there was a kid living, and most of us have a kind of idol. We usually at one point in our lives there is something that we identify with. There is somebody who we see, we admire fantastically. Usually some older kid in the neighborhood. You know what I'm talking about there. You remember that, don't you? Well, there was a kid across the street who was about 5 years older than I was. And this kid was the golden person of the neighborhood. He played on the football team, you know, and he was a big deal on honor rolls. He was picked. He was always picked. When there was any choosing upsides, he was doing the choosing. He was never really picked. He was always one of the center of everything. And he was building, among other things, he built model airplanes, and he did all these things. But he built radio sets. Well, I would go over to his house, along with a bunch of other kids, and I was fascinated by the radio sets he had. You know, he would build breadboard radio-type receivers, and it was just an amazing thing, fantastic thing, and a very admirable thing to me. Well, he read a magazine called Shortwave Craft, which I began to read, although at first blindly, because I was not really interested in radio until I began to be interested in, you know, becoming kind of involved. And the next thing I knew, I am avidly reading Shortwave Craft every month when this magazine came out. Shortwave Craft was a magazine of how to build shortwave receivers, how to listen to shortwave receivers. And the idea, of course, of building these things was important, but listening was even more important. To hear Spain, to hear Cuba, to hear Rome, to hear all these things on a receiver that you made yourself out of about $4 worth of stuff, or stuff usually that didn't cost anything, from old radio sets that you'd find down at the Salvation Army. Well, Hugo Gernsback, 1 month, and I must have been about 13 at this point, and I'd built several crystal sets, and I had now arrived at the point where I was going to build an actual receiver. And I was reading all the plans, and I'd learned how to read diagrams and the whole business. And it was vicarious all at first, you know, truly vicarious. It's like a guy who reads yachting magazines and never owns a boat, you know, that kind of thing, or a guy who it's like Playboy readers, you know, who only read about girls, you know, who only read about, you know, they think they're interested in girls. Well, really, what they dig is pictures. It's a very different thing. That was the way it was at first with me. I'm reading about all these guys, and there were always articles in Hugo Gernsback's magazine about particularly successful shortwave listeners who had built this equipment, and then their walls were covered with QSL cards, you know, all the stuff they heard, it was a wild world, a great world. So I came to the point where I was really going to build a piece of equipment, and I began to assemble the parts. Now, the receiver was called the Acylodyne, and that's one thing about, yes, Hugo Gernsback was continually inventing new circuits, and this was the age of truly backyard-type electronics, and Hugo Gernsback would invent a new circuit, and then it would say the two-tube DX special oscillograph type, and it would be a two-tube receiver with a special kind of feedback circuit that would give you higher gain. The tickler circuit was especially adjustable so that you could adjust for fine plate oscillation and negative feedback and regeneration. They were big on regeneration. So the particular receiver that I remember was called, I wonder if any of you ever built this thing, was called the Acylodyne. It was called an Acylodyne tool. Well, I started to build this thing, and for about 4 months, I worked on it. I had assembled the UV-30 tubes. I got this thing working. Worked and worked and worked until finally it came to the point where I was trying it out, and I could never get it going. It never would work. It was like a white whale. And I would check my diagrams, and my father had to learn how to read diagrams because he checked them for me. And it would not work, absolutely refused to work. And Hugo Gernsback had published the Acylodyne. Well, you know, this is a terrible thing. Most people today buy kits and that, but what are you going to do with this lump? You've got this stuff, and I didn't know enough to do anything about it. All I knew was to follow the circuit and the diagram and read the instructions, which read something like this. Immediately upon the completion of this receiver, install your filament batteries. It worked off of flashlight batteries, by the way, and a B eliminator. It says, install your filament batteries, advancing gain R1 slowly till the point of regeneration is reached. Immediately upon regeneration, you will hear a pop in the earphones. Then begin to move C2, the tuning condenser, back and forth over the band. You will notice immediately a profusion of whistles. This profusion of whistles shows the extremely high gain. The tremendous gain of this receiver is now in full swing. Back your regeneration control off just a tiny hair 9 until you are right at the edge of regeneration, and you are now ready to tune in the world. Go, man! Well, all I got was a dull, solemn, sullen hum. Now, anyone who has ever built electronic equipment knows this is just some... Ooh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And I would try everything, you know, check, recheck. And my father kept saying things like, it must be in the coils. You've done the coils wrong. Well, the coils were wound on two bases. You know, you wind 27 turns of number 22 wire, and then you wind four turns of number 22 wire spaced a quarter of an inch away for the tickler. And all that, nothing, you know. It just went on and on. Well, about 6 months later, I have now switched to model airplanes. But my subscription, which was given to me for Christmas of shortwave craft, continues to come. But every month when it would come, there's that sick feeling in your stomach. Do you know what I mean about the sick feeling of having gotten yourself caught in something that you shouldn't have? Like some guys will buy a gigantic boat or something, and it sits down there on the Sound, and it costs $4,000 a week just to keep down there, and you hate boating. You know, there's a sick feeling every time you go past water, or every time you even think about it, or you go past Macy's where you bought it. You know, there's a rotten thing. You know that terrible feeling of having done something? That's a feeling that's hardly ever described. Of having made a commitment that was done on some kind of false enthusiasm or some passion that didn't last long. And it's a long commitment. But I'd like to know the number of fantastic marriages that have been... Right now, guys are feeling very uncomfortable about that one, you know. Or guys will rush out and buy a $74 painting set. Oil painting type thing, you know. They have in the spur of a great discussion they had at Charlie's house one day about how much fun Charlie got out of painting, and the guy rushed out and buys this great big set. Now it's way down underneath the overshoes and stuff, and you kind of want to push it away so you don't see it. Well, my radio, my Acylidyne, which I had worked, and by the way, I had argued with my mother for like months to go down with me to Allied to buy a condenser, which cost $1.74, a Hammerlund condenser, a special double-section condenser, which did not come in the old used receiver, which I had taken most of the parts out. You had to get this Hammerlund 140 micro-microfarad condenser with special low-loss insulation, you know, to pull in Spain to make sure that I didn't get hand capacity and all that stuff that was so great. Well, I had that silver condenser with that white isolantite insulation there, and it was getting dusty. And it was a $1.74 investment in the days when a $1.74 was like 4 years allowance in advance. And now it was back on the top of my bookcase where I had all my model tanks and I had stuff like, ice skates and all that. And it was back and it was pushed away so that I couldn't see it. To see it, I had to make an effort. You know, I had to get up and look to see it. I had to, you know, that kind of thing. It was slowly beginning to sink down into that mire of all the unwanted stuff that we have in our lives slowly sinks into. Which eventually you finally get rid of it and you slough it off like an old carbuncle or an old coal sore. Finally it goes, well, my radio was beginning to disappear. No longer were people asking me, why you're working on your radio tonight, huh? And that kind of stuff. So one week I come home from school and there was shortwave craft. Well, I was tapering off, you know, how you still kind of look disconsolately. And they had a question and answer thing in this thing. It would say, Dear Mr. Hugo Gernsback, I tried a 17-volt C battery in your Nutridyne circuit, and I find that the amplification factor of 2 is jazzed all the way up to 2.5. Now, can you explain this? Why, when I raise the C battery voltage, does this happen? And Hugo Gernsback would say, the formula is very simple and can be found in any formula book. Next question. See, he's ducking the issue. And that's the kind of answers that Gernsback would give. Well, somewhere along the line, I'm sitting at this consulate, and the question says, dear Hugo Gernsback, I made your Oscillatine 2 4.5 months ago, and it's rotten. It does not work. Signed, J.W. of Berwyn, Pennsylvania. And underneath it says, dear J.W., you apparently missed issue number 17, volume 4, in which we corrected the plate circuit, which was badly printed, and due to an error in printing, we had said R1 is interchangeable with R2, and actually the two connections should be reversed. And thank you. Next question now. Little realizing that he had caused 17 million guys to want to commit suicide, you know? It's like ladies reading a great recipe in McCall's, and every time they bake it, it blows up the kitchen. You know, something like that. Well, yeah. I looked at that thing and it said reverse the connections. I sat there for about 3 minutes. Hugo Gernsback, if you're around listening, I don't think Life magazine reported this side of your career. Well, I got up after supper and I went in, and I was very afraid to start this thing again, you know, because there was a sick feeling in the stomach. A very sick feeling about that radio. By now, it had become a conscience thing. It was like Ahab. And, you know, we like Ahab because Ahab caught up with the white whale. But if Ahab had chased the white whale all through Moby Dick and never caught up with it, and then had gone into Volume 2, and then Volume 3, by the end of Volume 7, you'd be pretty sick of Ahab. But seriously, they wouldn't even talk about him at Farley Dickinson College. Forget Ahab. Well, see, I hadn't caught up with the white whale, and I was sick and tired of it. I was messing with Stinson Reliant kits now, and I was building Curtis Robbins, and I could make a couple of those work. Well, I went into the bedroom, my pad, that night, and I look up on the top of the bookcase, and I start digging the stuff out, and there it is, covered with dust. My little Hammerlin condenser there is now sort of at a half-mast, just sitting there at 30 on the dial. And dust, and my wiring is kind of cheesy now, and everything's kind of like that. I blow it. You know, because after all, you throw tennis shoes on the top of it for 4 months. It doesn't really hold up. I'm blowing it. So I take it down, and I get out my soldering iron. And I had, like most kids, I was a great collector. Some kids have collected every copy of Mad Magazine, that kind of thing. Well, I had every copy of Shortwave Craft, including the thumbed volume that had in it the plans for the Oscillatine 2. Well, I get out the thing, and I look at the drawing, and I see where what he's talking about, reverse these two connections. I didn't know why it would do it, you know. It just is reverse connection from R1 to R2, and it reverses. So I look on my radio there, and I get out my soldering iron, and I start doing all this stuff. And I had this soldering iron my aunt Glenn had given to me. And it was a 75-watt soldering iron. It was a terrible thing. And the tip kept getting unscrewed all the time. And one time, the red-hot tip got unscrewed while it was red-hot and fell on the rug, which was in my room, burned a hole in the rug right through the floor, and it went right down in the basement. And as far as I know, it's still burning down there. Well, so there are other things. So I got my soldering iron out, and I reversed R1 and R2, I reversed the connections, the B-plus on R1 over to the B-plus on R2, and reversed the two things. And I was afraid to try it. You know what I mean by being afraid to try it and why? Well, I was very much afraid to try it. And so I hooked up the batteries, and they were dead. After 4 months, no batteries. The tube didn't light. See? Nothing lit up. Well, now this meant I would have to go one more step. This was a genuine commitment. And I want to. Here is the point where we have arrived at the crux of the situation, which meant the difference in a whole life, really, literally. I had a choice of going down to Griselli's radio shop, where he sold tubes and stuff. And by that time, I'd accumulated about $1, you know. And I could go down and buy a couple of batteries for the tubes. And it was just little 30s. You know these little 30s? There were low-drain tubes that used standard flashlight batteries. So I'm looking there, and it's about 7 o'clock, and Griselli's closed at 8:30. I knew Frank Griselli was down there till 8:30. He was my local. I wonder how many guys listening right now had a local hero that was a radio serviceman, locally, a true hero. You ever gone into a radio, and this guy's sitting back there, and he's surrounded by Hickok. He's surrounded by all kinds of Hickok meters, Volt Ohmus and stuff, and he's got all this great equipment, and he just sits there, and he's a thin guy who spent all of his life in the basement working on field coils, you know, and this guy sitting down there, voice coils, and he knows, oh, he just sits there, and they always wear bad shirts. I don't know why it is, but guys who get involved in radio equipment don't know anything about ties. They're very bad on shirts, and they have a tendency to buy jackets. They're kind of jackets that you see over on 8th Avenue, you know that? And they also have a tendency to go for the kind of shirts where you have this sliding thing up near the top. This is also the science fiction crowd, you know, that pseudo-Western kind of string tie with that crummy 75-cent slide, you know, the thing with the horns on it. Oh, boy, they're awful. That's the kind of stuff they wear. Now, that's just a serviceman. You never knew about how servicemen dress, did you? And they go for jackets, short jackets, windbreaker-type jackets. And, yeah, they do. And they're kind of weedy people, and they sometimes have skin trouble because of all that time spent in the basement next to the furnace. And, you know, that sort of thing. Well, they are. So there was a guy, this guy, Frank Griselli, was a local hero of mine because he was a serviceman. Really, he was just, a friend of mine worked in the service shop in the, a ham friend of mine, who was an older kid, who was a ham, worked in that service shop in the afternoons. And this guy was a ham himself. So he became like, well, he was my Roger Maris. He was a ham. He had a service shop. And he had all this. So I was, that moment, I could have gone down to Frank Griselli's and bought the batteries. I had changed R1 and R2. It's now about 7:30. I have discovered my batteries are burned out. They're just slowly piddled out, and so there they were. So I'm fooling around. It's now about 7:45. And I'm feeling restless, and I know that all of us have had this moment when we were impelled by forces larger than us, things called life forces, fate, kismet, etc. It's now about 8:10, and I go out on the front porch. Summertime, you know. I go out on the front porch, and guys are knocking out flies and shouting and hollering. And I'm standing around there, and I holler to Flick, "Hey, Flick, how are you?" And I look at Flick. Flick looks, and I'm fooling around. And I wander on down the street in the direction of Frank Griselli. It is now about 8:10. Hugo Gernsback is playing an arpeggio in my life. I have now arrived down at the drugstore, which is about 4 doors away from Griselli's, and Griselli comes out. He is closing the doors early. Yes, Griselli is leaving. And I holler, "Hey, Frank!" And Frank looks at me, "Well, hi, kid, how are you?" You know, I was this kid that hung around there. "Hi, kid, how are you?" I said, "Say, Frank, I'd like a couple of 1.5-volt batteries." Because, you know, I'm talking to my hero. I've got to have something to talk about. I'm making an identification now. I says, "Frank, I need a couple of 1.5-volt batteries." "Oh, what for? For God's sakes, I'm closed up." I said, "Well, I've got something I'm working on, and if I don't get it, I won't be able to try it tonight, and I'd really like..." He said, "Okay, for God, come on. You got money?" And I said, "Yeah." Well, we go into his shop, and I love the smell of service shops. There is a great smell of burnt insulation and old solder, rosin core solder, and the smell of old, you know, the smell of tubes and cartons. Oh, there are few excitements that can match opening up a carton, a sealed carton of a tube, a radio tube. Yeah, you know, you just, oh boy, a new 6L6. It's a very exciting thing. So I get in the service shop. Now I'm excited. I'm now excited. I'm here. And so Frank is going through. He says, "I don't know, 1.5-volt. I don't think I've got..." By now I says, "Oh, yeah, you got to have some, Frank. I need them real bad. By this point, I need them." So Frank is going through the stuff. And he finds, "Oh, yeah, here we go. Okay, that's 22 cents each. 22 cents here. Do you want a receipt?" I said, "No." He says, "Let me check them." So he puts them in the little checker, lights the light bulb. He says, "Yeah, they're okay." "All right, kid, give me 20. So I give him 45 cents. He gives me the penny. And he goes his way. We go out. He locks the door, and there's this big thing that says Raytheon Authorized Dealer, you know, on the thing. And it says Arcturus Tubes, tested here, free, service done, calls service up. So I get out on the street, and I start going home, and now I realize I've got to go through with it. I have a pair of 1.5-volt batteries in my pocket. I get home, I go upstairs, I go into the bedroom, I look at my receiver, I got the batteries, I insert the batteries, the tubes light up, which is what they had been doing before. I had a pair of big Brandy's cans, earphones that weighed 9.5 pounds per each, great big fat cans of the, that had been found somewhere in some basement of some Salvation Army. I put the cans on. I plugged the earphone jack in the front of my aluminum panel, by the way, which I had bought down at the junk. I plug it in. I listen. And then I go back and it says Advance R1. The regeneration, this regeneration control clockwise, and as you advance it, you will hear a pop at that point. So I go, oh, it's not humming, it's just going. I advance it slowly, and it goes, it popped. I'm excited, it's just popped. It goes, I advance it like. I read the instruction. It says, now turn C2, which is your tuning condenser, C2, the double-section tuning condenser, tune it across the band. You will note a large number of whistles denoting the extreme sensitivity of the special Oscilladyne 2 circuit. And I go, oh, I'm hearing whistles all over the... Back and forth I go. It was just a whole sea of tiny little bird sheep's whistles all across the dial. It says, now, back off on your regeneration control to the very edge of oscillation, and you will begin to hear the world spread out before you. Particularly, we suggest you try the 49-meter band. Pew, I move it back, and I'm listening, and I hear this guy... This guy is talking in Spanish. Come in. He's going along there, a mile a minute. My radio is working. HC1AJ in Ecuador. And I start going across the dial. That was the beginning of the change. The whole life, everything that my whole life changed that very minute. I look down, and there in my bookcase, there are 17 copies, monthly copies of Hugo Gernsback's shortwave crap. They looked like they were gold, beautiful gold magazines. I go across that 49-meter dial, and I can hear birdies, cheeps, until 3 o'clock that morning. I'm sitting here. I'll tell you one thing about this receiver. If you got up and walked away from this receiver, it tuned across the entire 49-meter band by itself. For those of you who know anything about hand capacity. I'll tell you another thing, too, about this receiver. It put out a stronger signal than it received. This was a regenerative receiver, and if I had put a key in the negative lead, the B-minus lead, I could have easily have worked all continents. WAC, I'm 49 meters. This thing was putting out birdies all over the band. Another thing, too, about this receiver... It was like many of the pieces of equipment that guys build. It unaccountably gave you shocks. no matter where you touched it, I would get a shock. I would touch my earphones, I would get a shock. If I moved my head slightly to the right, I'd get a shock on the right side of my neck from the cans. If I touched my elbow on the desk while I was tuning R1, I would get a shock that would start at my elbow and go out my left foot. That kind of thing, you know. But it didn't make any difference. I'm sitting there with that juice flowing through me, with the hand capacity I got so that I could tune with my knees. I could keep everything going. I would sit there in front of that receiver, and if my mother walked through the living room facing west, she would throw out the entire 40-meter band. If she faced east, everything was fine. It was that kind of thing. But Hugo Gernsback changed my entire world. He really did. Hugo Gernsback. Now, the reason I'm bringing this up is Life magazine has an article, has a piece about him. And Gernsback represents something that will never, ever be again. And that is the unscientific scientist. Oh, yes, yes, truly the unscientific scientist who never thought there were such fantastic forces involved in the stuff that they did. They never worried much about that. It was a time when a guy would decide, if you want to build a giant color organ, for example, out of old Atwater Kents, he never thought that it was impossible to do it. He never even realized that it was really an involved situation. He would build it, you see, and it would work, giant stuff, waterfalls going. And then after that, he would consider this. Somebody came along then and told him what an involved series of waveforms he had been dealing with. He became very cowed and went back to his tube testing. He didn't fool around much with it after that. Well, Hugo Gernsback, if you think this guy's an interesting man, one of the most fascinating men I ever met in my life was a guy who died a few years ago, a man named Lee DeForest. Did you ever hear of Lee DeForest? Well, Lee DeForest, probably in his way, contributed more than even Marconi did to the fact that you can hear me tonight and the fact that you can sit and watch those rotten reruns on television and see all those bad movies on Channel 9. He did one simple thing. He placed the grid in between a plate and cathode. And up to that point, it had never been really considered. No one really knew how to do it. No one knew if it was done, it would mean anything. And Lee DeForest, again, an unscientific scientist, do you agree with me, did this. Well, what he did was create a radio tube. Up to this point, it had been a simple diode half-wave rectifier. He created a radio tube. He created, well, the first, you know, a transistor is merely a substitute for a radio tube. He created the first radio tube, literally, without which World War II would have been impossible. The atom bomb would never have happened. Are you aware of that? For all of Einstein, it would not have happened. He created this fantastic thing, and as far as I know, got absolutely nothing out of it. Yes, I'm telling you the truth, he got nothing out of it. Well, I remember the day that I met Lee DeForest, and I'm sent by the Army to this terrible, terrible radio school. This is one of the saddest stories. I should tell this as a separate story. Now, I think just a couple of seconds will suffice for this. I was sent by the Army to a very cheesy radio school. During World War II, a lot of terrible schools and things were given government contracts to train GIs fast. And I was sent to this terrible radio school. It was the kind, you know, that advertises in the back pages of magazines. Earn $10 a week in your spare time repairing radios. JWL of Hattiesburg, Mississippi, earns up to $4 an hour. You know, that kind of thing. Well, I'm sent to this awful radio school. And as a front, they had sitting in a back room doing little things like puttering around and erasing blackboards was Dr. Lee DeForest, a white-haired old man. And I guess I was, of all the GIs, I was the only one who knew what Dr. Lee DeForest had done. And I went back into his little room, a little tiny rotten plywood office. It was so sad. And here is this old man sitting there. And I said, Dr. DeForest, I just wanted to come in and shake your hand. And he said, oh, yes, son. And I said, yes, my call is W9QWN, and I just want to shake the hand of Dr. Lee DeForest. And he looked at me, and he says, well, thank you very much. And I said, yes, well, would you please autograph my Q&A? Would you autograph my Q&A? I said, well, I had a Q&A with me. And he wrote on it in a very shaky hand, best regards, Dr. Lee DeForest. And I went back out to my crummy, rotten radio course, and sitting in that room was this little old man. And he died a few years ago. As far as I know, nobody knows anything about him. Hardly anybody says, you know, he's not a hero. He's not Marconi. Don Ameche will not play him.